trying to whistle some 80s song stuck in my head. I don't know the lyrics, so I wouldn't be able to sing it to you. Apparently I can't whistle it either, but it's in my head. talking, do too much talking today. I'm not feeling. Well, as I would hope to feel most mornings. Thank you for joining me. Fake Dancing with Steve. Who wants to hear about my health complaints this morning? I have a sore back, a toothache. I need to go see a dentist this week. I think I'll just recite some poetry. This poem is, if you've watched the stream before, I've recited it many, many times. I'm sure many people are getting sick of it if you watch the stream regularly. I am working on learning other poems, but I don't have a lot of time, so sort of a slow go on those. Slow go on those. This is Pied Piper of Hamelin by Robert Browning. Robert Browning. Hamelin towns in Brunswick, my famous Hanover city. The river western deep and wide washes its wall on the southern side. A pleasanter spot you never spied. But when begins my ditty, almost 500 years ago, to see the townsfolk suffer so from vermin was a pity. Rats, they fought the dogs and killed the cats and bit the babies in the cradle, and ate the cheeses in the vats and licked the soup and took some ladles. Split open the kegs and salted the rats, they danced the men's Sunday hats, and even spoiled the women's chats by drowning out their speaking with shrieking and speaking in 50 different sharps and flats. Alas, people in a body too. Town hall came flocking. 'Tis clear, cried they, our mayor is a naughty, and as for our corporation, shocking, to think we'll buy gowns lined with vermin, for dolts who can't or won't determine what's best to rid us of our vermin. You hope because you are old and obese to find in the free civic world's ease. Rouse up, sirs, give your brains a racking, find the remedy we are lacking, for sure as fate you'll send me packing. At this, the mayor and corporation quaked with the mighty consternation. An hour they sat in council. At length, the mayor broke silence. For a gilder, I'd my urban gown sell. I wish I were a mile hence. It's easy to bid one rack with his brain. I'm sure my court had aches again. I scratch it so, but all in vain. Oh, for a trap, a trap, a trap. Just as he said this, what should hap at the chamber door but a gentle tap? Bless us, cried the mayor, what's that? With the corporation as he sat, looking little through wondrous fat. Nor brighter were his eyes, nor moister, than a too long opened oyster, save when at noon his paunch grew mutinous, or a plate of turtle green and glutinous, only a scraping of shoes on a mat. Anything like the sound of a rat makes my heart will pit-a-pat. Come in, cried the mayor, looking bigger, and in did come the strangest figure. His long clear coat revealed the head, was half yellow and half red. And he himself was tall and thin, with sharp blue eyes, each like a pin, and like loose hair and swarthy skin, nor tuft of hair on cheek, nor beard on chin, but lips or smile went out and in. There was no guessing his kith or kin, and nobody could enough admire this tall man in his quaint attire. Quoth one, it's as my great-grandsire, starting up at the trump of doom's tone, had walked this way from his painted tombstone. He advanced towards the council table. To please your honors, said he, I am able, by means of secret charm, to draw all the creatures living beneath the sun, that crawl or swim or fly or run after me so as you never saw. And I chiefly use my charm on creatures that do people harm, the mole and toad and newt and viper, the people call me the Pied Piper. And here they notice round his neck a scarf of red and yellow stripe to match with his coat itself, saying check. And that scarf's end hung a pipe, and his fingers, they noticed, were ever straying, as if impatient to be playing, upon this pipe, as low it dangled, over his vesture so old fangled. Yes, said he, Pied Piper as I am, in Tartary at Brent the Cam, last June from his huge swarms of gnats, I eased an age of the Nizam, of a monstrous brood of vampire bats. And as for you, what your brain bewilders, if I rid your town of rats, will you give me 1,000 guilders? 50,000 was the exclamation of astonished mayor and corporation. Into the street Piper stepped, smiling first a little smile, as if he knew what magic stuff in his quiet pipe a while, like a musical adept, to blow his pipe his lips he wrinkled, and green and blue his sharp eyes tinkled, like a candle flame where salt is sprinkled. Then every shrill notes pipe uttered, you heard as if an army muttered, and the muttering grew to a grumbling, and the grumbling grew to a mighty rumbling. And out of the house came the rats tumbling, great rats, small rats, lean rats, brawny rats, brown rats, black rats, gray rats, tawny rats, brave old plotters, gay young friskers, fathers, mothers, uncles, cousins, cocking tails and pricking whiskers, families by tens and dozens, brothers, sisters, husbands, wives, followed by Piper for their lives. From street to street he crept advancing, and step for step they followed dancing, until they came to the river Wester, wherein all plunged and perished. Save one, who stout as Julius Caesar, swam across the limp to carry, as he the manuscript he cherished, to Rat Lanthome his commentary, which was, at first shrill notes of the pipe, I heard a sound as of scraping and tripe, and putting apples under his right, into the solder press's gripe. and a moving away of pickle tub boards, and a leaving a jar of concert cupboards, and a drawing the corks of train oil flask, and a breaking the hoops of butter casks. And it seemed as if a voice sweeter far than my heart or my solitary is breathed, called out, "Oh, rats, rejoice, the world has grown to a vaster and sultry. So lunch on, crunch on, take your nunch on, breakfast, supper, dinner, lunch on, and just as a bulky sugar punch on, already staged like a great sun shone. Gracious, scarce an inch before me, just as methought it said to come for me, I found the west of rolling over me." You should have heard the Hamlin people ring the bells till they rock the steeple. "Go," cried the mayor, "get long poles, poke out the nests and block up the holes. Consult with carpenters and builders, and leave in our town not in a trace of the rats." When suddenly up the face of the piper perked in the marketplace, "The first, if you please, my 1,000 guilders. 1,000 guilders, the mayor looked blue, so did the corporation too, for council dinners made rare havoc with claret, moselle, vin de gras, hock, and half the money would replenish the cellar's biggest butt of Rhenish, to pay this sum to a wondering fellow with gypsy coat of red and yellow. "Besides," quoth the mayor with a knowing wink, "our business was done at the river's brink. We saw with our eyes the vermin sink, and what's dead can't come to life, I think. So, friend, we are not folks shrink from our duty of giving you something to drink, and a matter of money to put in your poke. But as for the guild is what we spoke of them, as you well know, was a joke. Besides, our losses have made us thrifty. 1,000 guilders, come, take 50. Piper's face fell and he cried, "No trifling, I can't wait beside. I promise a visit by dinner time, Baghdad, and accept the prize of your head cooked potage, alms rich in, for having left in the caliph's kitchen of a nest of scorpions, no survivor. With him I proved no bargain driver. With you don't think I'll pay to stiver. And folks who put me in a passion may find me pipe after another fashion." Morning, Roland. It's been a while. I haven't seen you around these parts. There's some sort of emergency occurring across the street from me. There's a fire truck. I'm not sure what's happening. Exactly, there's a condo over there. Good morning.
Hey.
Where was I?
I don't know.
Piper's face fell and he cried, "No trifling, I can't wait beside. I promise a visit by dinner time, Baghdad, and accept the prime of the head cook's potage. All he's rich in, for having left in the caliph's kitchen of a nest of scorpions, no survivor. With him I proved no bargain driver. If you don't think I'll pay this diver, and folks who put me in a passion may find me pipe after another fashion. How, cousin, do you think I broke, being worse treated than a cook, insulted by a rival, idle pipe and vesh your pible. Threaten us, fellow, do your worst, blow your pipe there till you burst." Once more he stepped into the street, and to his lips again laid his long pipe with smooth straight cane. An airy blue three notes, such sweet soft notes as yet musicians cunning never gave the enraptured air. There was a rustling that seemed like bustling, a merry crowd jostling and pitching and hustling. Small feet were pattering, wooden shoes clattering, little hands clapping, and little tongues chattering. And like foals in the farmyard with barley is scattering, out came the children running, all the little boys and girls, with rosy cheeks and flaxen curls, and sparkling eyes and teeth like pearls, tripping and skipping ran merrily after, the wonderful music was shouting and laughter. The mayor was dumb and the council stood, as if they were chained to the blocks of wood, unable to move a step or cry, to the children merrily skipping by, could only follow with an eye, the joyous crowd of the piper's back. And how the mayor was on the rack, and the wretched council's bosom beat, as the piper turned from the high street, to where the west had rolled its waters, right in the way of their sons and daughters. Our return from south to west, and to come over hill the steps addressed, and after him the children pressed, great was the joy in every breast. He never crossed mighty top, his force to let the piping drop, and we shall see our children stop. When lo, they reached the mountainside, a wondrous portal opened, wise, and if the cavern was suddenly hollow, the piper advanced and the children followed. And when all were into the very last, the door in the mountainside shut fast. Did I say, oh, no one was lame, and could not dance the whole of the way? And in after years, if she was lame, in sadness, he was used to say, is dull in our town since my piping's up. I can't forget that I'm bereft of all the pleasant sights they see, which the piper also promised me. For he led us, he said, to a joyous land, joining the town in jest at hand, where waters gushed and fruit trees grew, the flowers were forth a fairer hue, and everything was strange and new. The sparrow was brighter than peacock here, and their dogs outran our fellow deer, and honeybees lost their stings, and horses were born with eagles' wings, and just as I became assured, my lane foot was speedily cleared. The music stopped, and I stood still. I found myself on the side of the hill, left behind against my will, to go now limping as before, and never hear of that country more. The fire truck left. It's no longer there. Alas, alas, for Hamelin, there came into many a burgher's pate, a text which says at heaven's gate, opes to the rich and has easy rate, as the needle's eye takes a camel in. The mare sent east, west, north, and south, to offer the piper by word of mouth, wherever it was men's lot to find him. Silver and gold to his heart's content, if only he'd return the way he went, and bring the children behind him. But when they saw it was lost endeavor, and piper and dancers were gone forever, they made a decree that lawyers never should think their records dated duly, if after the day of the month and year, these words did not as well appear. And so long after what happened here, on the 22nd of July, 1376, and the better in memory to fix, place of the children's last retreat, they called it the Pied Piper Street, where anyone playing piper tamer was sure for his labor to lose, was sure for his future to lose his labor, and suffered they shot hostelry or tavern, to shock with mirth the street so solemn, and opposite the place of the cavern, they wrote the story on the column, and on great church window painted, the same to make the world acquainted, how their children were stolen away, and there it stands this very day. And I must not omit to say that in Transylvania there's a tribe of alien people who strive their way in dress, of which their neighbors lay such stress, to their fathers and mothers having risen out of some subterranean prison into which they were to pan long time ago in a mighty band out of Hamelin Town in Brunswick land. But how or why, they don't understand. There we go. The Pied Piper of Hamelin by Robert Browning. Wobba Browning. The Pied Piper of Hamelin. one day God said, this is what I'll do. I'll send down my son. I'll send him down to you to clear up this humpity bumpity hallabaloo. His name will be Christ, and he'll never wear shoes, and his pals will all call him the King of the Jews. He didn't come in a plane, he didn't come in a jeep, he didn't come in the post of high jumping, go weep. He came in, he rode on the back of a black S2, the blackest creature he ever viewed. He rode into Jerusalem, home of the grumpy Jews, where prophets were worshipped, some even in twos. There was Murray Bomber and Genghis Bulbous, the one you can worship too is snooze. Christ spoke from a mound, just a pile of ground, people gathered around without making a sound. Thus he spake, sin in socks, socks full of sin. How shall we quiet this Jehovah-y din? Do unto others as others do unto you. That includes you, Timothy Foo. One Pharisee said to another he knew, what shall we do about this uppity Jew? Wash him in wine and make him all clean, and put him into Sam Vittles' crucifixion machine. Twirl the parole and release the gablees, and angle the nails as fast as you please. And instead he said as he bled, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do, because they walk through the world wearing two crappity shoes. Do you? I hope that poem doesn't offend anybody. I'm sure it would. It's not really fun. It's a skit by the Kids in the Hall. One of my favorite. I guess in medieval Europe, it might be considered blasphemous. In this day and age, nobody should be offended by that. Kids in the Hall. Here's one I've been working on. It's, what's it called? To the Dark Tower, Child Roland Came by, I think it's like Dante Rossetti. I'm check that out. First thought was he lied with every word, that hoary cripple with malicious eye, askance to watch the working of his lie, on mine, and most scarce able to afford, suppression of the glee, that pursed and scored its edge, at one more victim gained thereby. What else should he be sent for with his staff? What save to waylay with his lies and snare, all the travelers that might find him posted there? And ask the road, I guess what skull I laugh and break, what crutch can write my epitaph for pastime in the dusty thoroughfare. If at his counsel I should turn aside into ominous track where all agree hides the dark tower, yet acquiescently I turn as he pointed. Neither pride nor hope is kindling at the end described, so much as gladness that some end might be. For what with my whole world wide wondering, what with my search drawn out through years, my hope dwindling into a ghost not fit to cope with that obstreperous joy success would bring. I hardly tried now to rebuke the spring, what heart made finding failure in its scope. As a sick man very near to death, seems dead indeed, and feels begins and ends the tears, and takes farewell of each friend, and bids one the other go, draw breath freely outside. Since all is over, he saith, and the blow fallen no breathing can amend. While some discuss if near other days be room enough, and one a day seeks best for carrying corpse away, with care about banners, scarfs, and staves. And still the man hears all, and only craves, he may not shame such tender love and stay. Thus I had for so long suffered in this quest, heard failure prophesied so oft being writ, so many times among the band to wit, the knights who two dark towers search address their steps, the jest to fail as they seemed best, and all doubt now was should I be fit. So quiet as despair, I turned from him, that hateful cripple, out of the highway, into the path he pointed. All the day had been a dreary one at best. The dim was settling into its close, yet shot one grim red leer to see the plain catch its astray. For mark, no sooner had I fairly found, pledged to the plain after a pace or two, then pausing, throw back a last view over the safe road, 'twas gone. Gray plain all round, nothing but plain to the horizon's bound. I must go on. Naught else remained to do. So on I went. I think I never saw such starved, ignoble nature nothing throw, for flowers as well expect a cedar grove, but chortle and spurge according to their law, might propagate their kind with none to awe. You'd think a bird had been a treasure trove. No penury and inertness grimace in some strange sort were.
I don't know very well.
Still working on this one. No penury inertness remains in some strange sort were the land's portion. See or close your eyes, said nature peevishly. It nothing skills. I can't help my case. 'Tis last judgment. Fire must cure this place, calcine its clods, and set its prisoners free. That's all I know for now. My first thought was he lied in every word. That hoary cripple with malicious eye, asking to watch the working of his lie. In mind, scarce able to afford suppression of the glee, the person scored its edge at one more victim gained thereby. What else should he be set for with his staff? What save to waylay with his lies and snare all travelers that might find him posted there? Nast the road, I guess what skull like laugh would break, or crutch can write my epitaph for pastime in the dusty thoroughfare. If at his counsel I should turn aside, into ominous track for all agree, hides the dark tower, yet acquiescingly I turn as he pointed. Neither pride nor hope rekindling at the end described, so much as gladness that some end might be. For what with my whole world wide wondering, what with my search drawn out through years, my hope dwindling into a ghost, not fit to cope with that obstreperous joy success would bring. I hardly tried now to rebuke the spring, my heart made, finding failure in its scope. As a sick man buried near to death, seems dead indeed, the field begins and ends the tears that takes farewell of each friend, and hears one bid the other go, draw a breath freelier outside. Since all is over, he saith, and the blow fallen no grieving can amend. While some discuss if near other graves be room enough for this, and when a day suits best for carrying the corpse away, with care about Bohemian scarfs and staves, and still the man hears all and only craves, he may not shame such tender love and stay. Thus I had for so long suffered in this quest, heard failure prophesied so oft being writ, so many times among the band of wit. The knights who two dark towers search to dress their steps, to fail as they, that just fail as they seem best. And all doubt was now, should I be fit? So quiet as despair, I turned from him, that hateful cripple, out of his highway into the path he pointed. All the days would be a dreary one at best. And dim was settling into its close. Yet shot one grim red leer to see the plane catch its stray. Fort Mark, no sooner had I fairly found, pledged to the path of plain after a step or two, after a pace or two, then pausing to throw back one last view over the safe road, 'twas gone, gray plain all round, nothing but plain to the horizon bound. I must go on. Not else remained to do. So on I went. I think I never saw such starved, ignoble nature. Nothing throve, or flowers as well expected. Cedar grove, but chortle and spurge, according to their law, might propagate their kind. With none to awe, you'd think a burr had been a treasure trove. No penury, inertness, grimace, in some strange sort were the land's portion. See or close your eyes, said nature peevishly. In nothing skills, I can't help my case,
'Tis last judgment's fire must cure this place, calcine its claws, and set its prisoners free. Thank you. Hamlin Towns in Brunswick by famous Hanover City. The river west is deep and wide, washes the wall on the southern side. A pleasanter spot you never spied, but when begins my duty almost 500 years ago to see the town to itself so from Britain was a pity. Rats have hunted the dogs, killed the cats, bit the babies in the cradles, and ate the cheese from the vats and legs sick from the crypts and ladles. Split open the cakes, salt and spice with nests, and then Sunday half, and even spoiled the women's chats by Johnny out there speaking, we shooting and speaking, 50 different sharps and flats. At last, people in a body to the town hall came flocking, tis clear, fine day, our mayor is a naughty. And as for our corporation, chalking, think we buy gallons, lying with ermine, for those who can't or won't determine what's best to rid us of our vermin. You hope because you're old and obese to find a very civic world, please. Rails up, sirs, give your brains a rack, and find ermine if you're lacking. By this very corporation, point for point, plus nation. An hour of these sacred council, I'd like to mayor broke silence for a gilder, I'd my ermine gown sell. I wish I were a mile hence. It's easy to bid one rack, one brain, I'm sure my forehead aches again. I scratch it so, but all in vain, all for a trap. This is, he said, this what should happen, not the chamber door, but a general tap. Let's ask, cried the mayor, what's that? Which corporation, as he sat, looking little through wonder is fat, no brighter were his eyes, no moisture, than too long open.